Hai, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and a very good day a bit to Dr. Muhammad Fauzi bin Ismail. My name is Muhammad Firdaus bin Ahmad Tosim. So today I'm going to present on my mini project. The title is OSH Implementation at the Industry. So for the introduction part, the objective of this project is to study the implementation of the Occupational Safety and Health Administration on the real industry. So for this project, I choose to conduct my study at Gaya Plus Sdn Bhd, which was my industrial training placement back then. Gaya Plus is a SME manufacturing company that involved in plastic industry located at the Teluk Panlima Garang, Selangor. Gaya Plus Berhad has been established since 2006 and operating until now. So the main activities there is manufacturing the plastic jerry can. Gaya Plus also has the mutual relationship with UiTM when they collaborate in manufacturing the G95 face shield during the early pandemic COVID-19 situation. So the nature of the business of this company is manufacturing and also the trading of the plastic jerry can. In this activity, it involves in using the extrusion blow molding machine, and the raw material involved is the high density polyethylene, calcium carbonate and also the master batch. The activities here involve in hands-on operation such as cutting, transport material to load to machines, packaging and also the hand grinding. For the first part, I'm going to present on the facilities for OSHA that exist or should exist on the site. So there are four aspects of OSHA facility that have been identified here. So the first one is the isolation method, where the control room and office are isolated from the production line to shield from dangers like noise exposure, and also they provided the proper isolated of the crusher room that provide a noise exposure to the worker. As for the engineering control, they have the proper chemical storage room and the covered compressor area. For the administration control, the management have provided the proper signage and also the safety notice for the worker, including briefing on emergency exit plan in case of emergency happen. Next is on the personal protective equipment, PPE. The management team have provided the complete PPE for the every worker, such as the hand glove, safety boots, safety shoes, safety vest, hairnet and also a safety helmet, and also the safety goggles. The second part is on the type of hazard identified and the actions needed to be taken. The first one is the mechanical hazard, specifically on the impact hazard. So it comes from the activity of the forklift that parked in the walkway. The problems are coming from the negative behavior of the worker when they did not want to park the forklift at parking spot provided. Here, it can accidentally hit worker or people and can cause falling by hitting the nearby objects. The suggested action need to be taken is to monitor and discipline practice for the forklift driver. Next is on the mechanical hazard, specifically on the cutting hazard. So, it comes from the activity of the exposure of sharp objects to the people and the worker, and also the unsafe placement for the bench grinder. The problems are coming from the improper location provided for the bench grinder stations. So here, it can cause the cut to people who accidentally hit or near by the bench grinder. A preventive action is to provide a safe placement for the bench grinder that far from crowded place for worker or exposed to people. Then, for the physical hazard, which is on the noise exposure, it comes from the activity of the worker that is exposed to noise at work for a long period. So these hazards are coming from the crusher machine that produce loud sound during the process of the crushing the products. So here, workers are exposed to loud noises in a long time can cause death to the worker. So the suggested preventive action is to have a proper monitoring of PPE for the worker during the crushing work process. Besides, the management team can limit the work time for the worker near the resource of the noise. The last one is on the electrical hazard, which is caused by the exposed current wiring to the people or the worker. So the causes are the improper management of the wiring at the stations. So for the consequences, so it can cause the electric shock to the worker, accidentally can injure the worker. So for the preventive action, it is suggested to have the proper adjustment or provide barrier and also to manage the wiring system at the workplace. So for the next part is on the standard operation procedure, SOP, in the event of the emergency. So the first one is on the fire evacuation. So as the first step, once the alarm triggered, security guard will first view the alarm panel for the triggering area and make announcement to the security control. So then the security control will then notify the maintenance department in order to ensure all person in charge to switch off all valve and switches, well as notifying the incident controller and evacuation committee before proceeding to assembly point using the emergency route provided. However, the incident controller will verify the situation by calling 999 to reconfirm whether there are disaster happening or it is just a false alarm. Security controller will be notified. The security controller will then notify again the evacuation committee regarding the verification from the 999. Hence, information center is activated. So the emergency manager will then justify the conditions. If there is a true disaster occurring, then firefighter is called. However, if it is a false alarm, then all employees will go back to work. As for the injury or death accidents, all incidents occurring within the premise of Gaia Plus must be notified by the reporting person to the safety and health department using the incident or accident notification forms. Instant reporting of severe accident or incidents by the phones where the event has occurred, safety and health department should be informed immediately by not neglecting the first aid or medical treatment by head of department or immediate superior of people at the area. DOSH or safety officer will determine which level of beyond investigation is necessary and whether response to the incident is required based on the facts taken from the phone chat. If needed, DOSH may contact the OSH committee members or safety officer at the facilities to assess of the situations. Even though a telephone call to DOSH has been made, an incident report form should still be completed and submitted as described above. In the event of any accident or occupational disease involving more than 4 days of medical leave, report shall be referred to the Division of Human Resource for the purpose of making a SOPSO report. So these are the two forms that needed to file a report for further investigation. So as for the last part of this presentation, I'm going to present on the Occupational Safety and Health Management System. So the first one is enforcement of OSH by using a legal requirement like OSH 1994 and also the FMA 1967. So next is the use of the safety committee to facilitate HSE management system. Then the company also provided the PPE to the worker to ensure safety of the people in the work area. Next is the use of the OSH management system. This is particularly important when interface between system include communications between multiple of departments and also contractors. Then the company also provide the safety working procedure of working scope such as the safe guidance to operate machines and also the forklift. Lastly, the awareness and training program for all workers to ensure the risk that they taken when they are working on the area. So the last part has wrapped up my presentation. That's all from me. Thank you.